You know, I think the funniest thing I have ever seen was when I saw Bigfoot mimicking you about the time you two ran into each other in the forest. I mean, the way he mimicked your facial expressions and made tiny little squeals to show how you were screaming and mimicked how you ran and flopped your arms. And I'm telling you, it was just hilarious. Oh, well, maybe you just had to be there. And hey, if you were there the night that he said you were, you know, I think you should probably get ahead of the game and go defend your reputation. Send me an email with your version of events, because Bigfoot's threatening to film himself telling the story while he's mocking you so he can put it out there on YouTube. Just saying, you should probably tell your side of the story first. Send it to me at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. We'll get it out there and we'll beat him at his own game. I can't wait to read it. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello, everyone. Glad to see everyone has their snackage ready to go. We have a couple comments that were left on videos over the last couple weeks, and then we have an encounter tonight from one of our very own Sasquatch members. So get your rump up there in the saddle. Don't forget those extra apples. Put them in the saddlebag, because not only do they work as great bait for Bigfoot, your horse will appreciate it too. And for those of you out there who don't do horseback riding, like Tater, who prefers an ATV, if I recall, you know, that's okay. You just come on along with us however feels most comfortable for you. All right, are you ready? Let's get moving. You know, Sasquatch Valley is still many, many miles off, and there ain't no time to lose. First up, we have a comment that was left on Bigfoot Acknowledges Hunter's Presence. That was released on May 10th of 2022, and here is what Barbara wrote. I believe I may have had a Class B encounter nearly 50 years ago. The occasion was a blind date with the son of one of my mom's friends. We were spending the weekend in Yakima back in the summer of 1971. I was 16, and my date was a nice fella that played football for Notre Dame. We'd gone inner tubing down the Yakima River in the daytime. It was summertime, with temps in the 90s, so it was not only fun, but refreshing. After that, we changed clothes and locations to the mountains east of Mount Rainier and 30 to 40 miles west of Yakima. It was at the end of an old logging road with a little stream running next to it. There was nobody within miles and miles of our location. My date had cooked an awesome meal of steak and mushrooms on a little hibachi in the forest under the stars. As we were finishing our food, we heard what sounded like a person saying, "Quack, quack, quack," from up in a tree across the little stream. Then we heard a soft thud. Upon investigation, we saw a dead duck lying on the ground. We hadn't heard any wing beats, and it just seemed very strange. About an hour later, we had packed up our stuff and were just about to leave when I realized I had dropped something. I thought maybe it went flying when we shook the blanket off. We went back to look for it with the headlights on bright. We were on our hands and knees facing the truck when a big fir tree behind us started being thrashed about and shaking violently. The tree made a lot of noise, but there were no animal sounds. If it had been a bear, we probably would have at least heard a couple grunts or huffs. Nothing. And I don't think even a grizzly could shake that big of a tree from top to bottom with such force. We never saw what was making this 100-foot-tall fir tree look like it was going to explode. But it had to be something extraordinarily big and strong. I'm glad we didn't see it or hear it, because it was only about 30 feet away, as well as I can estimate 50 years later. My suspicion is that a Sasquatch was up in that tree and had been attracted by the smell of our food. I know they imitate owls. Why not ducks? And I think it grew impatient for us to go so it could investigate if there were any leftovers. When we got back out of the pickup to search for the missing item, I think it decided to scare us and make us leave. If so, it was very effective. This 6'4" or so football player raced me to the truck, and we both jumped in and locked our doors. That man had to drive in reverse for a quarter mile before there was enough room to turn around, and he was not going slow either. I bet from then on, he made sure he was parked in a position that enabled a quick exit when necessary. Funny thing, we didn't talk the whole drive back to my hotel. I saw him a few months later when he came to visit Seattle, and we never talked about it then, either. At first, I wondered if I'd been set up for a prank. But I never saw any payoff. Never any teasing, laughter, never even any discussion about it. So that theory got tossed. I honestly believe it was a Bigfoot. There are so many reports of them in the areas around Mount Rainier, Mount St. Helens, Mount Adams, and Mount Hood. In Skamania County, around Mount St. Helens and Mount Adams, it is actually illegal to shoot them, backed by stiff fines and imprisonment. What do you think it might have been? Well, Barbara, I think you could be right. It could be a Class B for sure. Everybody else, let Barbara know what you think of this in the comments below. Next up is a comment that was left on Grieving Bigfoot, released on November 3rd, 2020. This was left by Eagle Arrow, and here's what they said. During the North Carolina fires a few years back, we could see the smoke for weeks from Virginia. I believe Bigfoot moved north as we had all kinds of chatter in our woods and heard one in our backyard wanting our lab. When the lab ran in the house in a scurry as if it saw evil, it tipped me off to pay attention. A few minutes later, we heard the roar and were elevated up from a sitting position, then quickly back down like a small rumble earthquake. Then the Bigfoot hit our trees, walking away mad. In the morning, we saw our trees with bark missing where he or she hit the trees, about 5 feet or so up the trees. I think the fires moved them around. And the third and last comment we have tonight was left on a video from March of this year, 2022. I believe it was titled, Bigfoot Tears Through Coyotes to Save Kids. And here's what they wrote. Hi, my name is Stephen Terry. It's 2022, May. A few months ago, me and my ex-girlfriend were out hunting. I have hunted this area for the last 30 years, and I watch animal documentaries weekly, and I know what all the animals in the Northwest look like and sound like. I am in Eugene, Oregon. 30 minutes out of town is where this story takes place. Well, it was about 40 minutes before it was going to be dark, and my girlfriend wanted to take her little dog for a walk down the main road, for we were camping down a gravel road. Well, we only made it about 100 yards from camp, and off to the left of us, there was an owl in the old-growth timber, calling out to another owl that was off in the distance to the right of us. I decided to mimic the owls. I called back to them twice. And then all of a sudden, this loud, hoot-like yell came from inside of the tree line. It was so loud, it pierced right through our body. I dropped my bow instantly and pulled my pistol and pointed it toward where the sound came from. I then picked up my bow, and she grabbed her dog, and we went right back to the safety of our camp and my truck. Well, at this point, it's now dark, and we decided that we would go to sleep, and we would pick camp up when it was daylight. Well, just as we were about asleep, a huge tree or tree branch got broke. We could hear it snap and hit the ground. Just on the edge of our camp area, which isn't very big, we can hear rustling of the underbrush, and we can hear what sounded like something very big on two legs fade away from our camp area. So we went to sleep, got up a half hour before it was light out, made coffee, packed up everything, and left. I haven't been back in the woods. Last Saturday, I went back to our camp spot and found the only broke tree that was there. And it was very strange how it was broke and where. The way the broke piece was placed, I have a video of the tree, but I don't know how to add it to this story. I will try. It might show up separate. Now I want you to know, I never believed in Bigfoot, but since this happened, the only logical thing I can come up with as to what happened that day is Bigfoot. I never seen it, even though it only sounded like it was only 40 yards from us. It was dark in the trees. I can for sure say what it wasn't. It wasn't a bear, cougar, bobcat, elk or deer, rabbit or bird. So what else could it have been? If you want to share the story, you can. I haven't told anyone but my kids. They just blew it off as I was telling a story. I don't think they took me serious. And just for the record, folks, no video ever came through, so I did not withhold it. I know people think I withhold evidence all the time. I don't, I promise. All right, here we go on to our story from the Sasquatter. She titled it, I Am Brogan. My home is on Chestnut Ridge, a mountain range that stretches from the Laurel Highlands of western Pennsylvania into West Virginia. The area is known the world over for unusual events. I live on a private driveway. Though given a name by the township, the road is not maintained by anyone other than the residents. It's about a mile long from beginning to end. There are 8 homes occupied by approximately 20 people. About 2 feet wider than your average car, and you'll have to pull aside or stop if you encounter another vehicle while driving the length. It's a wonderful place to live. There are heavy woods on both sides of the road, and an abundance of wildlife visible at all times of the day and night. Constant birdsong is the musical score of the lives of those lucky enough to reside here. Even before purchasing the home, I suspected that there was at least one Bigfoot in these woods. In the 1970s, when Pennsylvania had an outbreak of Sasquatch sightings, this area earned a reputation as particularly active for cryptids, not only for Bigfoot, but UFOs, thunderbirds, and dogmen. The day of my sighting was not my first encounter with Bigfoot. My family and I call him Brogan. This is the name telepathically communicated to a family member one night as they slept. My name is Brogan, he said, and I am not happy about this change. Why are you here? The family member related that we had purchased the property and had come to live here. They advised that we meant no harm and relayed the hope that we could come to terms with a peaceful coexistence. Though not a party to telepathic communications, I sensed that Brogan was not happy with the situation and constantly hoped that in time he would come to know us and realize that we meant no harm and had no bad intentions. In the year that we have lived here, becoming accustomed to the property and the close proximity of our Bigfoot neighbor has been an adventure. On any given day, you could exit the home and step into total silence. The quiet lays like a blanket over the property. It encompasses everything, including the frogs that occupy our backyard pond. It's quite unnerving. It prompts you to look about while having the feeling that you're being watched. Any time after dusk, you'll hear the screams of a creature echo through the woods. A chilling series of 6 to 8 screams, paused for a quick intake of breath. The screams cause your blood to run cold and will prompt you to run back into the house to hide. Commonly referred to as that thing that screams in the woods, the noises have been explained as everything from coyotes to owls to mountain lions or bobcats. After research, I found a video on YouTube that is a perfect copy of the screams. It is, "This clip just captured the most terrifying sounds in the Canadian woods," posted by Rumble Viral. Now, Brogan's screams are not his only way of making his presence known. Several times when walking the property, I've heard him growl. Once when I ventured too close to the woods, he not only growled, he chuffed and dove deeper into the woods, using snapping branches and crunching leaves to punctuate his displeasure. Several weeks before my close contact sighting, I saw him one morning. I'd endured a sleepless night and was on my second floor deck at dawn, staring at the pond. Total silence descended a moment before I saw the reflection of a large, brown fur-covered bipedal creature as it walked from one stand of trees to another. Before I could gather my thoughts and look up, it was gone. On Sunday, May 9th, 2022, I had an encounter that left me rattled. It was Mother's Day, between 1 and 2 p.m., when I left my house to walk the half-mile length of the driveway to the property at the end of the road. We're a neighborhood of people who value their privacy, and though we're all on good terms, we'll seldom venture onto each other's land. During my dog walks, I go the length of the driveway to the gate of the property of the last home. I stop at their fence, and I turn back toward home. After I started my walk home, I saw what I thought was one of my neighbors come from the corner of their property and step onto the driveway. At this moment, both of my dogs started to whine and whimper, and they backed up. Total silence ruled as the creature crossed the driveway and disappeared into the woods. It was about 10 and 15 feet away from me. It dawned on me that this was not my neighbor. In fact, it wasn't even human. It was between 7.5 and 8 feet tall, with long, matted, dark brown and black hair or fur. It didn't look at me. There was no smell and absolutely no sound. It crossed in 2 steps, went up a slight embankment, and into the woods. I wasn't scared because I was too shocked to feel fear. It took several moments for me to resume walking. The dogs began whimpering and pulling on their leashes, and they dragged me back to movement. As I neared the area where it had gone into the woods, any and all thoughts that this was a neighbor vanished from my mind. There is no earthly reason that a human would have gone into that heavily wooded area. I paused to stare, but the dogs pulled me back into reality a second time. They wanted to go home, and they wanted to do that now. Keeping my eyes focused on the woods, we made a quick progress home. When we arrived, I locked the door the moment we stepped inside. Still feeling stunned, I sat down next to my husband and released the clasps on the dogs' collars. They ran upstairs to lay down on their dog beds. My husband looked at me and said, "What in the world is wrong? You literally look as if you've seen a ghost." I laughed nervously, but I couldn't speak. I hadn't realized, or perhaps hadn't accepted, the reality of what had happened. I remember feeling surprise, denial, fear, and disbelief all crashed together in my mind. Finally, I managed to say something. "I don't know what I just saw." "Was it a Bigfoot?" he said. "I think so," I replied. "It certainly wasn't human." "Was it a bear?" he asked. "No," I said. "I'm sure it wasn't a bear." "So," he said, "it was a Bigfoot." I could do nothing more than manage a few nods. It's been an interesting few weeks since this happened. I have yet to resolve the entire encounter in my mind. I've been honest with people who ask why I'm so preoccupied and a bit scattered. I know most people say that they find skepticism and disbelief when they relay an encounter like that. But of the people I've spoken to, only one has laughed at me. Most simply state, "Well, that's life on Chestnut Ridge." In these weeks, I have felt fear, concern, and I have questioned myself a million times, always repeating the questions in my mind. Did I imagine that? Did that really happen? Was that really what I saw? It's taken me 3 weeks to return to the place where it happened. I finally did so a few days ago, in my car, with my husband present. I have not walked the dogs because, quite honestly, I'm afraid to see it again. Other family members have assumed that chore for me because I have no idea when I'll be able to do it again. Since it happened, I've asked several neighbors if they've seen anything odd in the woods, and every one of them asked if I saw a Bigfoot, but they deny having seen one themselves. So why would that be their question to me, if they haven't seen one themselves? Please keep my name anonymous. Thanks, Nance, for telling my story. All right, well, thanks again to everyone who took the time to send their encounters in or left them in the comments section. And again, I don't mind people leaving their encounters or stories in the comments section, but sometimes they can be missed. So if you have something and you definitely want it narrated on this channel, you want to share it with the world, with the Sasquatch, with everyone, please send it to me in an email at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. And if the rest of you out there, if you see someone has left a story or an encounter in a comment section and you don't think you've heard me narrate it, just send me a screenshot or tell me which video and who said it. And I will see if I've done it. And if not, then I will put it up in a video. I appreciate it because more eyes out there means I'm less likely to miss some good ones. And I know I have. All right. Well, other than that, I just want to say that I'm really excited. My batch of special made Buckeye bars coming from Yeti Bar Soaps is due to arrive today. Yes, I'm excited. Can you tell? I can't wait to get them. And I will show you what they look like this Friday on the video. And as always, you can get your favorite scent at YetiBars.net. Use code BB10 for a 10% discount. Otherwise, I just want to say thanks for hanging in there all the way to the end and listening to me get all excited about some soap. Now, you know we'll be meeting up again very soon. But until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. I don't give two shiny rat buttholes what anyone says. It is not proof of absence, and you tell them I said so. All right, everyone. Thanks for listening. I'll see you this Friday.